As is the practice here, we start with some recitations from the Quran, the revealed book or the holy book. Okay, Sara, would you please do it for us?
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ليس البر أن تولوا وجوهكم قبل المشرق والمغرب ولكن البر من آمن بالله واليوم الآخر والملائكة والكتاب والنبيين وآت المال على حبه ذوي القربى واليتامى والمساكين وابن السبيل والسائلين وفي الرقاب وأقام الصلاة وآت الزكاة والموفون بعهدهم إذا عاهدوا والصابرين في البأساء والضراء وحين البأس أولئك الذين صدقوا وأولئك هم المتقون.
I welcome all of you with an Islamic greeting. Peace be upon all of you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Dear audience, the verse you have heard just now was from the Holy Quran, chapter number 2, Surah Baqarah, verse number 177. Now I will present the English translation before you all. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Virtue does not consist in whether you face towards the east or west. Virtue means believing in God, the last day, that is Day of Judgment, the angels, the book and the prophets. The virtuous are those who, despite their love for it, give away their wealth to their relatives and to orphans and the very poor and to travelers and those who ask for the charity and to set slaves free and who attend to their prayers and pay the alms and who keep their pledges when they make them and show patience in hardship and adversity and in times of distress. Such are the true believers and such are the God-fearing. Thank you so much.
Welcome once again to my presentation about understanding Islam. We are discussing understanding Islam, but I am starting, it might be surprising to you, I am starting with the structure of the atom. Now this atom, it has its nucleus where we know protons are there, neutrons are there, and these are the electrons which are always orbiting in exact shells, whether it is L, M, N or anything. The point is that this tiny atom, which is not visible to us, its components are bound by certain laws, what we call as the atomic laws. The electrons, where they orbit, the speed of the electron with which it is running around the nucleus, and the spins on its own axis, because if there are two electrons in one orbit, their spins are in opposite directions. They are governed by the atomic laws, which cannot be changed. We can study them, we have studied them, we can use them, we can harness them, but we cannot change them. Now from atom, if we move to space, and this is the sun and these are the planets which you can see here, the Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars and so on. They all have their fixed orbits and their own set of laws which govern their movement around their axis, on their axis as well as around the sun. So all these planets and everything in the cosmos, be it the stars or their planets or the moons, everything is governed by the laws, and those laws, you know, we know and understand in the sense that we can predict the sunrise or the sunset months in advance. That is, the movement of these bodies, the heavenly bodies, is so precise or so accurate that we can calculate things well in advance. Then we have the famous picture, if you remember, the dropping of the apple, depending the gravity, the gravitational forces of the earth. Here again, we find that we have gravity as well as other laws which govern the earth and the entire world, the life as well as the non-living on this planet. Then this picture shows the movement of the wind. why there is movement of the winds, the current, because if at some place there is a depression in the pressure, the air from the surroundings rushes to balance this pressure so that the balance is maintained, because in nature balance is very important. Even if at elementary level, if you have studied chemistry, we always balance equations. We look for equilibrium, that on either side there should be a balance of the reactants and the products. So in nature also we find a lot of examples of the balance, as one is this. So it means even the climate, the environment around us, the movement of the winds, it is controlled by certain laws, the atmospheric laws or the laws of the physical world. Then we have an example from our own body. In this nucleus we have chromosomes or the chromatin material. This is a theoretical diagram, of course, and this is consist of the DNA molecules. In this DNA molecule we have the sugar phosphate backbone, then we have the nitrogen bases, the thiamine, the adenine, guanine, cytosine. The interesting thing is that this base pairing is very specific. Adenine, as you can see here, adenine will always pair with thiamine, guanine with cytosine. It will never happen that cytosine pairs with thiamine. So this base pairing, and in fact the entire genetics is based on this specific base pairing. We cannot alter it. Then I have taken up this verse from the Quran, which says that, and whatever is in the skies and the earth is his, and his is the law that prevails forever. Will you then fear, obey someone other than Allah? What does it say here? That everything in the universe, as we have seen while moving this few examples, that whether it is the living world or whether it is the physical world, whether it is a micro world like that of an atom or a macro world of the cosmos, everything is governed by the set of the laws. So naturally very relevant thing is that everything is governed by the laws, that are there any laws to govern the humanity as such, or the human beings? How do they behave? How they are expected to behave? What they are expected to do? What they are not expected to do? Now this is reflected in this verse, and the God asks that everything you see in the universe is governed by the laws. Then do you follow some other laws other than that of the God? And this book, Quran, according to this verse, is binding, or what we call in Arabic, the farz, on all of those people who claim that they are Muslim. It is a binding book. Most surely he who has made the Quran binding on you will bring you back to the destination. Now this Quran, which incidentally is called the book of the Muslims, is in fact not the book exclusively for Muslims. This is a book of guidance for the entire humanity, and one Quran verse explains it. And there are many such verses which explain that this is a message for all mankind. So it means the Quran is not a book of Muslims, rather it is a guidebook. It gives us the methodology that how to lead life. And this book is meant for the entire humanity. It is not exclusively for the Muslims. This is meant for the entire humanity because it contains the basic principles that how you should conduct yourself, what should be the focus of your life, what you are expected to do and what you should do exactly. Then I have taken up couple of verses which emphasize that why humanity should exclusively follow it. This verse tells us that follow what has been revealed to you from your fosterer, and do not follow guardians besides him. How little do you mind? If you just stop for a moment and think that whatever we do or whatever we have been doing in our life, why we do it and who controls what we are doing. So normally in most of our cases what we find, that we do whatever we like. It means whatever we feel like doing, and we call it our liberty or the independence to do whatever we like. Normally what we do exactly what suits us or what we like. Many a times we do not consider that what effect it will have on others. You see, in this age where we understand the nature of the environment, the components of the environment and how they are linked. Initially, we never learned this basic thing that our activity, how it is going to affect the activities of the others or the lives of the others. For example, we have, or rather I would say, we had a very clean air on our planet. Things were going very well. Then came the Industrial Revolution, and we established lot of industries. They spewed lot of carbon dioxide and other gases into the atmosphere. Nobody noticed it. They were doing it because they were manufacturing certain things, and these were the byproducts of those manufacturing industries. They were just belching out tons and tons of carbon dioxide and everything. Then came a point when we realized that this is disturbing the balance of the gases in the atmosphere. It is affecting us. Now these effects are so profound now that we know that the glaciers are melting, the ocean levels are rising, and many countries, coastal countries, are feeling threatened because of the rise in the level of the oceans. So my point is that whatever we do, now we realize more that it is affecting the life and the working of the other, not only the human beings, but the other organisms as well. It means whatever we do is connected. There is an interconnect. This we realize after experiencing the bad effects of our activities. Had we followed the divine guidance sent to us, wherein things are clarified what to do or not to do, we could have avoided these things. And this is precisely, if you read Quran, in its translation which is available, I believe, in most of the languages which you read, English of course it is there, then it tells us what to do and what not to do. And this is important because whatever I am doing, we should never think that whatever I am doing is not going to affect the other, not only the human beings, but the other creatures which are thriving on this planet, because we have a shared planet. Whatever we have on this planet, we share with every living thing as well as the non-living things. And our activities are affecting not only the living world, but the non-living world as well. So these things are important, they should be kept in mind. So that's why it is said that whatever has been revealed to you, it is a divine message. It has been revealed to a prophet called Muhammad. And in fact, according to the Islamic beliefs, Islam was not introduced by Prophet Muhammad, as you said. It is believed that the first person who came on this earth, that is the Adam, and we all are children of Adam, he was a Muslim. Now, who is a Muslim? Is Muslim a person? If it is a male having a beard or a cap, and if it is a lady wearing an hijab, or a person offering prayers 5 times, or fasting for 30 days, how do we define a Muslim? You know, Muslim is an Arabic word. In Arabic, we have the systems of the root words. So the root words for the Muslim are S-L-M, or in Arabic, Sin, Lam, Mim. Now this root word has different meanings, but if we put them all together, then in one sentence it can be said that whoever follows the divine laws or the principles is a Muslim. The one who submits to the divine laws. So that way, any object, be it living or non-living, who follows or which follows the divine laws or its laws, is a Muslim. Say for example, start with the atom. The electrons and the protons and neutrons are Muslim because they follow the atomic laws. I hope you are getting my point. Because it has nothing to do with the so-called religion. It is something to follow the given laws. And we know that all the creatures on this planet, they follow the given laws. You have seen the examples. Be it the DNA molecule from the living world, or the planets, or the atom, or the air currents, or the air movements, or the temperatures of the oceans, anything, it follows the given laws. Now these laws we know are created by the Almighty. We cannot change them. So whoever follows the laws made for oneself is called a Muslim. Yeah, this is in Arabic, the kalima, what we call the kalima, or the a statement which if somebody recites, this is what is said, if somebody recites it, he becomes a Muslim, and you might have heard it, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. What does it mean? There is no God but one God, and Muhammad is the Prophet. So Muhammad, in fact, Adam was the first Prophet or the first Muslim who followed whatever was revealed to him. Then, throughout this period of human civilizations, this story goes like this, that the prophets came in different areas to different populations, in fact, in all those areas where human habitations were there. They brought the divine guidance to keep the humanity on the right path. And what was the right path? The right path was to peaceful coexistence happily and following the divine laws which are given to you. And in essence, these laws are meant to make you a good human being, the one who cares for others, who is not self-centered, taking care of the interest of one own self, rather of the entire humanity in the planet. But at the same time, normally people who are guided by their own desires or wanting to do things for their own benefit, they always challenge these rules, and gradually they distorted them and changed them. It means what happened, in fact, that the divine messages came. These messages in due course of time were distorted or modified. And they were modified according to the whims and the fancies of the people who wanted to change it. This process continued, that is, the prophets were sent, and in fact, as a belief system of Islam, we believe in all the prophets who came one after the other, including Jesus or Moses or David. All those people, as a Muslim, we believe in all these prophets, their prophethoods, as well as the divine texts which were revealed to them, including the Bible and the Torah and everything. This is a part of the belief system of Islam, that the one who subscribes to Islam will subscribe and will have faith and will believe in all the revealed books, as well as all the prophets, the number of whom runs into thousands, we know, over the history of civilization, over the history of human existence on this planet. So we believe in all that, and it is believed that in this chain, the last of the prophet was Muhammad, to whom this Quran was revealed as the last textbook. And it is said in this Quran that this is the last textbook which we are revealing, and we are protecting it, and its protection is our responsibility. This is a statement from the God. And how this protection is done? That from day one when this book was revealed, it is learned by heart. And we have on this planet millions and millions of people who remember it from A to Z. They remember the entire text. So now naturally, when so many millions of people remember this book by heart, it is very difficult to change it, to temper it or modify it. This is one thing. Now the essential belief in the Islam is that we believe in one God. Believing in one God, what does it mean? It means that we simply follow the rules and the laws given to humanity by that God. It means one God, one set of laws, and submission to one entity. So whatever has been revealed to us, revealed to humanity, that is to be followed. So that is the concept of oneness of God. It is not just one entity. And the concept of prayer in Islam is not a mere ritual where you bow down to something or prostrate to something. This is done, but what in essence is needed, that you submit to the guidance by your heart and put it into practice. So literal physical prostration is not that important as is the importance of the laws which are being followed. So when in Arabic it is said that La ilaha illallah, what does it mean? There is no God but God. So the interesting thing here is that this important statement starts with negation. It denies God. No God but the God. What it means that the other gods which we follow or we have been following, godly systems of obedience. Listening to what? If we have been doing things according to, say, what the people are doing or what we feel like doing, then we are not following the guidance given by the God. So this is the concept, that first you shun all those practices which have been in vogue and follow what has been revealed to you. The next verse elaborates it a bit. Have you seen him who takes his low desires for his God? What does it mean? How desires become your God? Because God is one to whom you follow, to whom you submit. If we submit to our desires, low desires particularly, specifically, then your low desires are your God. Even if you are saying that I believe in one God, it means nothing, because you are just verbally saying that you believe in one God, but you are not following the guidance of that God. You are following the guidance and the motivations of your own self, your own desires. I hope I am clear, and please feel free to ask questions. It is a discussion, one to one, not a speech. So don't take it as a speech where I am just delivering something. You are free to interrupt me and you can ask questions, or later on you can ask, but my point is to make you clear. So am I clear here? That the submission means submission to the revealed laws by the divinity, and if you do not follow that, it means you may be prostrating, but you are following your own desires. So whatever you follow is your God. If you are following your customs are your God. If you are following your family practices are God. If you are following your own desires or your whims and fancies, this is my life, this is the slogan of the youngsters. If you are doing living like that, it means your own desires are your God. And this is what this verse explains, that have you seen him who takes his low desires of his God? Will you then be a protector over him? Or do you think that most of them do hear or understand? They are nothing but as they. They are even less conscious of the right way. So it means the people who follow their own desires. The Quran says that they are worse than the animals, because they are not able to see beyond their own self. They are doing everything to serve them only, nothing for others. And he guides unto himself all who turn unto him. Now this verse clearly explains that if you need guidance from God, you will have to turn to him. Turning to him doesn't mean that you start going to a mosque and start prostrating. What in fact means, you must read the guidance which has been revealed to you, that is the Quran or the divine book, see what it says and put it into practice. So once you take this course, then you are seeking guidance from the God, and then the guidance comes. Unless we take our own initiative, the guidance will not come. It is not something which will be, you know, bestowed upon you or thrust upon you. If you ask for it, you get it. If you don't ask for it, you don't get it. It is simple. If you want to travel to some place, you will have to get a vehicle and then start moving in the right direction. If you just don't do that, you will not be able to reach there. But that is important, the initiative from the humanity, initiative from the human beings. Now this verse, it says that, and he it is who made you successors of the earth and raised the grades of some of you above others, that he may test you through that which he has given you. This verse defines the role of human beings on this planet. We are not the masters of nature. We are not the conquerors of nature. We are the custodians of the nature. Whatever is on this planet, on this earth, we are the custodians. We are the successors. We have inherited it. And we have different grades of the people. Some are say in terms of money, some have more money, some are richer, some are poor, then the God says that this difference is for your testing. That is, those who are wealthier, what do they do with their wealth? So whatever resource you have, if you have any plenty, then what you do with it, that is a sort of test for you. By equitable distribution, this is a very important concept from the Quran. Since justice, equity and balance are the main planks of Islamic system, Islam asks believers to treat all natural resources with the same spirit. Quran declares it without any ambiguity that whatever is in earth, He has created for everyone. This is exactly the verse. He it is who created for you all that is in the earth. هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا. Your God is one who created everything on this planet for all of you. It means we have the common resource base, a common heritage, the common air which we all breathe. You come from different countries, from different places, but we all breathe air. And this air has no boundary. You cannot say a person from the Brazil, of course you have wonderful, the green lungs of our planet, the beautiful forests, the emerald forests, they produce a lot of oxygen, but that oxygen is not meant only for the Brazilian people. It moves and travels across the globe and everybody benefits it. Similarly, an industry throwing out tons of carbon dioxide will not remain confined to that place only. It will travel even to the Brazils and the Canada and Tobago and elsewhere, and will pollute and will poison the people who breathe in that air. So the resources are common, and give to the near of the kin his due, and to the needy and the wayfarer, and do not squander wastefully. I have picked up selected verses from the Quran which specifically tells us those messages which I believe are not important at the moment for the humanity. So the wasteful attitude is strictly restricted by the Quran for the entire humanity, that whatever resources you have, use them judiciously. The Quran asks the people to be frugal, be judicious in the resource utilization, don't squander away, don't adopt a wasteful attitude where you can go on wasting the things because it is my money, I have every right to use it the way I want. No, resources are limited. You can accumulate wealth, but when you buy things unnecessarily and throw them away, say for example, we go out for a lunch and order a couple of dishes, eat a small amount and rest we throw. You may say, and this is one attitude, this is my money, this is my food, I have bought it, and if I have not used it, I can throw it. But at the same time, the other view is that this much food you are going to destroy while many people are hungry. You have no right to encroach upon the accessibility rights of those people who do not have anything. So you have money, but you have no right to waste food which you have bought out of your money. I hope I am clear. So this is a very important concept which you must know. So this is what is forbidden in Islam. These are the commands of the Quran, and every command is binding to one who submits, Muslim. So whoever submits, and if somebody does not follow it, it means he is not a perfect Muslim. Because we are choosy. We are taking some of the guidances which suit us, but we are not following those guidances which we feel are not good for us or which we cannot afford to follow. This is not Islam. Islam is 100% submission. Either you follow God or don't follow. There is no compromise that partly God, partly others. This is strictly forbidden in Islam. Now these commands of Allah about resource sharing are also found operating in nature. The process of photosynthesis occurring in nature may be taken here as a relevant ayah or the sign. Now here I would like to clarify two things. That the Quran, it tells us that there are two types of the signs, the ayah. One is the written verse, or you can say two types of verses of Quran. One set of verses is written in the form of the text. If you pick up Quran, there is a textual material, the material in the text. The Quran said it, this is one set of verses. The Quran tells us the other verses are the creations all around us. It means the animals, the plants, mountains, wind currents, clouds, rains, name anything in nature. The Quran says these are all our verses. Verses in the sense that if you explore them, you will understand the wonders of God, what God is doing. Because if somebody asks me, maybe you only, that who is God? Where can I see? I have no answer. But what we can see the wonders of the God in its creations. So if you understand creation, you understand creator. Or in other words, we can say, we can appreciate creator by appreciating the creations. So that's why the Quran says that all these creations in nature are the signs, S-I-G-N, the signs of the God, the creator, how things have been created. So those creations, since they follow the laws set for themselves, are believed to be Muslims because they are following the laws. Now I have picked the one example here. As you can see, this is a plant. Now plants have green parts and non-green parts. The green parts do photosynthesis, and what happens in photosynthesis? The carbon dioxide and the water is mixed together and they produce glucose, the sugar, which we all need, all human beings need. Now these leaves which are green, they produce sugar. What do they do with the sugar? Because this is their resource, it is their earning, they have produced it. We find in nature that this glucose or the sugar is transported immediately from green parts to non-green parts, mainly the roots which are down the soil, deep into the soil, because these non-green parts are not in a position to prepare this sugar, and sugar is the food of the plant. So green parts immediately transport the sugar to the non-green parts. And this transport is governed by a law known as the law of diffusion. What does it say? Everything in nature moves from a region of high concentration to a region of low concentration, or from a region of high free energy to a region of low free energy. What does it mean? That the distribution of resources in nature is as per the need. According to the need, if something is somewhere in plenty, it is transported immediately to a place where it is wanted. This is a best, I would say, illustration of the distribution of resources. How this nature, these natural signs of the Creator is teaching us how to share our resources. We have the verses of the Quran which tell us that whatever is in the earth is for all of you, and practically this verse shows us that in nature the laws of diffusion are operating, and this law of diffusion is in operating in our own body also. The gas exchange which occurs in our lungs, we absorb oxygen, give out carbon dioxide, this is again based on the law of diffusion. If the law of diffusion stops operating, none of us will survive. So the survival of the entire life on this planet is based on the law of diffusion. That what is that? Movement of resources is according to the need, from the region of high concentration to low concentration. So this is, it means, simply speaking, that if you have a resource in whatever form, you are sharing it and distributing it according to the need of the people, then you are a Muslim. These things which are believed to be good deeds, they are the commands from the God, the Creator, and if you follow them, you are a Muslim. So that way Islam has a different, I am describing it in a different context. It is not a set of prayers or rituals that if you do the prayer this way, you are Muslim, do this way you are a Christian, do this way you are a Hindu, though it is something different. Here the prayer is following the command, not doing a ritual. You're getting my point? And these commands are all this with the commands which are meant for the betterment of the entire humanity. The Quran forbids you to accumulate resources for your own self, for your future investments. What it says, that whatever you need, fulfill your immediate needs and then spend it on the others who need it. Hoarding is not allowed. Take care of the other people. We will take care of you, you take care of the people. So in Islam, this is a prayer. This is worship. Worship is not a ritual where you do a particular act. In Islam, everything, every command from Allah, the God, is to be followed, and that is the worship. Including the ritualistic worships which we do, say praying for 5 times or fasting for 30 days in a year, that is also part of the worship. But these acts are also the acts of the worships of the prayers. Now Muslim character, a glimpse. What good deeds the Quran teaches the one who submits to it. Behold, Allah enjoins justice. It means the one who claims to be a Muslim must be a just person, always doing justice. And justice with everything, starting with the relationships. Have I done justice being a father, as a son, as a brother, as a sister, as a neighbor, as a citizen? We have to do justice. Justice with the responsibilities. So this is an important plank in Islam. All those who submit to this book, they must do justice. They should be the people doing justice. And the doing of good, they should always do good to others. And generosity towards fellow men. Generosity, I think these are self-explanatory things, we all know it. And he forbids all that is shameful and all that runs counter to reason, illogical things, as well as rebellion. What is rebellion? If you are asked to do something, say for example, it is forbidden in Islam to be extravagant, to lead a life of exhibitionism. And if we do that, then we are a rebel. We are not following the command. We say that we believe in Allah, we believe in one God, but we are not putting it to practice. So this is a rebellion. Tell the believing, is it the right one? Yes. Tell the believing man to lower their gaze and to be mindful of their chastity. This will be most conducive for their purity. Verily, Allah is aware of all that do. I will take up the next verse also and then I will explain. The next one says, that was 30, this is 31. And tell the believing women to lower their gaze and to be mindful of their chastity and not to display their charms in public beyond what may decently be apparent thereof. Hence, let them draw their head coverings over their bosoms. The important point here is that verse 30 instructs men, 31 to women. That is, in Islam, the chastity for men is more important than that of a woman. This is contradictory to our society, where we are more conscious about the women than of men. The Quran asks the men to lower their gaze, not to stare. Staring is something which is forbidden in Islam. Don't disturb people, particularly the women. Lower your gaze, keep it down, don't stare, and protect your chastity. That is, remain faithful, remain within your wedlock. Your relationships, your sexual relationship should exclusively with your wives. So no sex beyond marriage, no sex before marriage. This command is given to men first, to women later. This is an important point because in our society, the patriarchal society, the male-dominated society, these things are not taken care of that way. So that's why I said these verses are important. And the servants of the most gracious are they who walk on the earth in humbleness. So if one remains humble, the entire process of his humbleness is an act of worship because he is following what has been commanded. So I hope I am clear, because in Islam the prayer or the worship is not only ritualistic. Whenever you follow what has been you asked to do, it is your act of worship. So that way, if one remains humble throughout one's life, his entire life becomes a part of the worship. Don't be arrogant, be humble, be nice, be gentle, be polite. All this is acts of worship. And when the ignorant address them, they reply with words of peace. So don't pick arguments. Just be peaceful and say salam to them. You see, Muslims greet each other with salam alaikum. What does it mean? Literally it means, it is an Arabic sentence which means peace upon you. So it is a sort of a statement that when we meet people, we say peace upon you. So it is a declaration that from my side, peace for you. The other person replies, wa alaikum assalam, yes, to you also peace on you. So it is a mission declaration that we are at peace with another and we should remain at peace with another. Remaining peace with one another or maintaining peace amongst ourselves, what does it mean? It simply means that you should be very tolerant. Tolerant of divergent views or different opinions. You must be comfortable. One is free to have one's own opinion. And the other one should be comfortable with it. One may differ with me, even in beliefs, in faiths, in opinion, we should be comfortable. Why should I feel perturbed if somebody has a different opinion than that of mine? This is peaceful coexistence, and this is what Islam preaches. That be comfortable with the people, whatever they are saying, because they are answerable for what they are doing, you are answerable for what word you are doing. If you are reacting and misbehaving, then you will also be responsible for it, or rather you will be held responsible for it. You are answerable for it. And when the ignorant address them, they reply with words of peace, and they who pass the night standing and prostrating themselves before their sustainer. And they who, when they spend, are neither extravagant nor parsimonious. That is a balance in spending. Judicious use of resources, be it spending. And they who do not call upon another God with Allah and do not take any human being's life which Allah has willed to be sacred otherwise than in the pursuit of justice and do not commit adultery. Three things mentioned. Do not call upon another God, what does it mean simply? That they do not subscribe to other commands, only to the command of Allah. Because one God means one command. And whatever command the God has given, the latest edition being in the Quran, we have to follow it, not to take any other God, not to submit to any other system or any other belief system or any other man-made mechanism. That is it. And they do not kill people. The Quran very clearly says that you don't have to kill. And do not take any human being's life. The life which Allah has willed to be sacred. The life of each and every human being is sacred. Allah has declared it sacred, and no one is authorized to do it other than in the pursuit of justice. Of course, if in the course of justice, the courts of laws have found that this person be hanged, there is a different story, but no single individual on one's own is permitted to kill anybody. This is what Islam says, and they do not commit adultery. And they who do not bear witness to what is false, they will never be a witness to falsehood. They will always stand up for the truth. They will always try to establish truth. They will never support the falsehood or the false systems. And when they pass by what is vain, they pass by nobly. Ignorant. They ignore the things which are not of relevance to them. And they who reminded of their sustainer's messages do not fall down thereat deaf and dumb. This is a very important verse. And they who, when reminded of their sustainer's messages, the messages of the God, that is the even Quranic verses, they do not fall down thereat deaf and blind. It means the believers are those who use their intellect and the mind even when the verses are taught to them, when the verses are told to them. They have every right to ponder upon them, about them, and maybe to raise questions about them. Because sometimes it is believed that this is a divine message. Nobody dare ask any question. Nobody should raise any question. We simply should follow it. So this blind following is forbidden in Quran. No blind following, even the verses of the God are told to you. You have every right to use your intellect and the brains and analyze them and see whether they are correct or not. It means the usage of our intellect is very important in Islam. It totally forbids to do blind following. Blind following is totally forbidden. What it says, verily, the worst creatures in the sight of God are those deaf, those dumb ones who do not use their reason. You see, this verse is very, very profound and clear about it. That the God, in the sight of the God, worst are those creatures, the dumb and deaf people, who hear dumb and deaf doesn't mean literally, physically dumb and deaf. One who becomes dumb and deaf because he's not using any reason. Not using his or her intellect to analyze things. The use of reason and intellect is very important in Islam. And all have degrees and grades according to what they do, and your sustainer is not heedless of what they do. This was I picking that what they do is important. It means in Islam it is important what you do. The emphasis is not on thinking on the recitations, verbal recitations, the emphasis on doing things. You see, if I am a Muslim, one thing can be I can go on reciting the verses of the Quran. And don't do accordingly. Don't do what I am commanded to do. Then this is not the right Islam. Islam means whenever you recite the laws, the verses, you recite them to understand them and to put them to practice. Mere recitations is almost useless because it does not provide any relief to the humanity. You see, I am asked not to hold up resources, rather to spend it on the needy. But if I only read these verses, read and recite and read and recite, how the humanity is benefited? The humanity will be benefited only when these verses are put to action. When they are transformed into my deeds, into my doings. And it is doing which will be accounted for. And this is what this verse says. That is important what they do. And your sustainer is not heedless of what they do. The God knows what we are doing. And that's why He asks us to do a certain set of things, which are for the benefit of the humanity. And if you do not do, then the God says that I know what you have been doing. Shall I continue? Are you getting my point or getting bored, frankly? Is it okay? Feeling comfortable? Okay, because the one important point which I just want to take up, the concept and purpose of knowledge. Because in Islam, what does the knowledge means? And what we are expected to do, what we are supposed to learn, and to what use we should put it. This is the important verse which tells us, read in the name of the sustainer, who has created man out of a germ cell. Read, for thy sustainer is the most bountiful, one who has taught man the use of the pen and taught man what he did not know. This is believed that this was the first verse which was revealed to Prophet Muhammad. Iqra bismi rabbika allazi khalaq. Read with the name of thy sustainer. It means the first and very important message of Islam is to read. But read it with the name of the sustainer, that is, keep the sustainer's guidance in your mind always. That is important. And it is narrated as an attribute of the God that He taught you to write with pen and taught you, revealed to you what you didn't know. How this happens? It happens, it is possible when we use our intellect and our senses to learn about things around us. This is the process of learning. The process when you pick up a pen and start writing and start learning, then you learn the things around you. Then you come to know about the things which are all around you, be it of any nature. Now, most surely in the creation of the skies, heavenly bodies and the earth and the alternation of the night and the day, there are signs for men who understand. Now, this is the verse I was referring. This is one of those verses which tells that all the creations of the skies and the earth, they are the signs for the men who understand. They are the signs, they are the verses of God. But they will become verses of God to whom? Who understand. That is, if I understand the functioning of a plant as a botanist, as a student of botany, then these plants, they become a verse or the sign for us. And this is what I, while discussing the photosynthesis in a green plant, I correlate it. That if I understand the process, similarly if I understand the geology or the mountain formations, then I can understand that how God created it. And when I say how God created it, what does it mean? It doesn't mean God came himself down. It means how they were created according to the law set by the God. Are you getting this point? Because the law has created laws. The God has created laws for everything. And with those laws, the wonderful phenomena of nature are occurring, producing different things. If you understand or appreciate it, that way we can appreciate the Creator, that how he has brought about these creations. So there is a relationship between the Creator and the creation. So this is one of those verses of the Quran which tells us that there are verses in nature also, and if we understand them, we can understand God. So that is the main concept of knowledge in Islam. It means in Islam, knowledge is a way of learning about God, a discovery of God. It means discovery of nature is discovery of God. You learn the creations, you learn the Creator. You know about the creation, you know the Creator. So this concept given by Islam, given by the Quran, is very interesting. Here the exploration of nature is for realization of God, God realization, as well as, of course, taking advantage or benefit from those verses and then putting those things in the service of nature, in the service of the people, sorry. Now, couple of verses I have picked up from the Quran which say, he it is who made the sun self-luminous and the moon radiant. Now, this is a very important point because, you know, Quran is now more than 1400 years old. More than 14 centuries back it was revealed. At that time, nobody knew that sun being a star has its own source of energy by fusion reactions. This verse tells us that sun, which is self-luminous, generates its own luminosity, produces its own radiation because of the fusion reactions, because of the burning of the hydrogen gas, now we know it, and the moon radiant. Now today we know, but at, you mean, 14 centuries back, nobody knew about the laws of reflections of light or diffraction of light. This verse tells us that the moon, which is radiant and programmed for it, stages that you may know the number of the years and the keep the account. This is the development of the lunar calendar. Allah did not create that, but with truth, he explains the science in detail for the people of knowledge. It means if you have knowledge, these signs are clear to you. So this is an important relationship between Islam and knowledge. If you have knowledge, you will appreciate creations, and if you appreciate creations, you will appreciate the Creator and would become a good Muslim. Muslim in the sense, the one who submits. The once you know a system, it is good, then you try to join the system. Say for example, if we talk about the educational system, a student is staying in India say any field of science, he realizes during course of his study that this system of education, say in US, is better than mine. He goes to US and joins the system because he likes the system, how it is operating. So that's why these systems are very important. Did you not see that Allah sends down the water from the sky, then we bring out through it foods of different colors, and in the mountains there are white and red layers and others of different colors, and still others intensely black, and among mankind and other living beings and the cattle too, their colors are different likewise, only those among his servants fear Allah who have knowledge. Now these are the illustrations of these verses, different colors of fruit, different colors of rocks and the mountains and the animals. And Quran says, only those among his servants fear Allah who have knowledge. Because who know God would fear God. And God realization is through knowledge. If you have knowledge, you know the creations. If you know the creations, you realize the creator. And if you realize the creator, then you will fear. Fear of what? That I should follow what I am asked to do. I should follow the divine laws, divine rules, because if I won't follow, the bad would come to me. But bad in what sense? As I mentioned, that if we had followed these guidances, we would have never disturbed the environmental balance. There would not have been any pollution, because we are not expected to pollute things, to destroy their balance, to destroy their purity. We should have being the watchdogs and being much careful to protect all those resources, so we could have avoided the situations, the ills and the diseases which we are getting today. And this is one example. There are many things which we have not followed as per the divine guidance. We have followed keeping in mind our own interests, and they are causing a lot of harm to us, to entire humanity, not only humanity, to the entire planet and its inhabitants. Now this verse further clarifies the relationship of knowledge which Islam tells us. And the day we will gather from every community troops of those who denied our signs, they will be formed into order ranks. Until when they come, he will ask, did you deny my signs and did not comprehend them in your knowledge, or what is that you did? This I have written in red because this verse tells us that at the day of judgment, when the entire humanity will be there before God, he will ask that you denied my signs, my verses, without comprehending them with your knowledge. What was it you did? It means the mission of the humanity on this planet is to appreciate and understand the creations, appreciate the creator, and through this knowledge, they harness the benefits of all those creations and put it to the service of humanity. Simply speaking. Thanks for your patience. So it means, if I sum up what Islam is, of course the word means submission. Submission to divine law. The last revealed book is Quran. It has been protected. It has been protected for the last more than 1400 years, because the text is intact. Nobody has changed it because people remember it by heart. If you read the translation of the Quran in your language, what you get from here, that it has messages to make all of us a good human beings. The worship of the prayer in Islam is not ritualistic. It is following the divine laws and doing good to others. All acts of doing good to others are acts of worships and the prayers in Islam. In brief, I don't know how far I succeeded in giving a brief sketch of the philosophy of the Islam, because Islam cannot be taken as a religion which practices certain rituals. It is not specifically based on the worship system, it is based on the submission system. One should understand the difference between the worship and the submission. It is a system of submission where you follow every aspect of your life is governed by the divine laws. So we can say this is 24/7 system. Whatever I do, whatever I wear, whatever I say, whatever I read, and whatever I think is governed by the divine laws. That is Islam. And if you do that, that not only you who will be at peace, it will be entire humanity who will be at peace. Because there are few of the commands which I have picked up, you can see, they are wonderful messages of justice, equity, taking care of everybody, respecting everybody, be a tolerant person, be comfortable with dissent, be comfortable with the other point of views. This all is Islam. Simply speaking, be a good human being. Thank you very much. But questions, of course, any clarification or the question if you have. Yes, sir.
Thank you so much for the wonderful presentation. I just want to get a clarification on the part where you said read in the name of the sustainer, and you emphasize so much people should read and write. So I was thinking, maybe for your guidance, doesn't it exclude the illiterate? What if someone is not educated?
Yes. It is a part of the Islamic system that everyone should be educated. Islam does not conceive or think of a person who is illiterate. It means literacy is 100% compulsory in Islam. It motivates and makes his binding on the entire humanity that you must be a literate person. And it makes the responsibility of the entire society, not only the parents, that ensure that every child gets the knowledge, gets the learning. That's why I said the distribution of resources. If I am a rich person, I can send my child to best of the school of the town, paying thousands of dollars per month. But if you are not taking care of the children who are the street children or the street vendors or doing petty jobs, are not able to read, then I am answerable for them as well. This is the responsibility starting from the parents to the neighbors in the society and the government to ensure that everyone gets the knowledge, becomes a person who is willing to learn things, or in that way becomes a literate person. Am I clear? It's a response. That's why you see, Quran says that what we have, whatever we have given to you, is certainly given to you, but is not meant only for you. And this is what I discuss with my students also, that, you know, I don't know the structures in your countries, but in my country, in most of the government institutions, including this university, the education is funded by government. It means if I am getting education, from where are you getting money? From where? Whose money is spent? Not mine, because it was self-financing. Taxpayer money is supporting me. So throughout my education, it is the taxpayer of the society which has supported me. You believe it? My education is supporting my society. Once I get educated and get a good job, what happens to my earnings? Does it go to my family only or to the society? In 99% cases, it remains confined to my family. Whatever I earn, I spend on my family, not on the society, which has made it possible for me to earn this much amount. This is inhuman and un-Islamic. Islam teaches us that we have given you an amount, but that should be shared with others. That's the concept, including education. That's why when we say, read with the name of thy sustainer. Name of thy sustainer means that you must remember the commands of the God in your mind. Whatever you read, whatever you do, the divine command should be in your mind. You must be conscious of God. God consciousness is very important. God fearing is not that important as is God consciousness. You must be conscious of the God. Whatever you do, you must be conscious that, am I doing the right thing? Is it as per the divine guidance? Or I am becoming a rebel sort of thing? That's important.
Maybe I understood his question in a little different way. In case if I didn't get the opportunity to study and if I'm illiterate, is there any way that I can be a good Muslim?
Of course, why not? But the thing is that...
I hope it was that kind of question he asked.
You see, the moment you realize, who stops you to read and learn? If you are not literate, then and you want to become a Muslim, you can start your process of learning things as much as you can. You see, I am answerable to whatever things I have at my disposal, as per my ability, as per my potential. That effort must be started. Follow your question?
Yes.
Sure, clear? Because once I realize, I must start it. Whenever we wake up, it's morning. This is what he said. Am I clear? Or would you like to clarify it further?
No, I think because there is adult education also.
Yes.
Whenever you feel you need to learn, that is the right time.
This is self-education, in fact. Yes.
When a bad government is ruling and taking some right of the people, oppress the people, how Islam see the struggle of seeking justice? It's like a rebellion or doing the will of God?
You see, as a person, I must do good with the people around me, starting from my family. And once I do it, people will appreciate it and will realize the benefits of being just. So that way a micro society will be created. As we go on doing good, this micro society will expand, and then naturally in due course of time it will take up the challenge with the government. The best thing is to avoid conflict. Conflicts are never beneficial. We must devise ways to improve things peacefully. And the best thing is that if you say that this model is bad, establish a model which is better. Let the people compare and decide and switch over to this system. So the process of making things or doing or you know presenting alternatives in a peaceful manner and with a conciliatory approach is always better. It is always good not to very bluntly challenge people. Develop an alternative which is better, people will realize it and they will adopt it, but it must start with doing. I should be the first person, or you be a change what you want to introduce. So the change should come with me, in my family, in my near circles, and then like ripple effect it should increase. To me this is the best way. I don't say this is the only way. To me this seems the best way. I may be wrong. You may have a different perception, but that's how I see it. Because challenging and confrontation, it immediately breeds and develops a negativity. And it is very difficult to do some positive work in a negative environment. So start with the positive move and do positive things.
I think because most of the times, usually people have this question, in case there is a state-sponsored genocide kind of thing, what is our responsibility? How do we react to it?
Develop an alternative system peacefully. Because otherwise also if you use your mind, you cannot challenge that state, because the state has the strength and the power. You will be eliminated in a minute. Then a crusader has gone. You have the right mind, you could have done something, you lost the opportunity. So it is better to devise ways where you are able to deliver. That's how I see it. Anything else? Okay. Thank you very much for all your patience. God bless you. Assalamu alaikum. Peace upon you. Thank you.